Hi guys! This week's video was actually recommended by Angela Holmes, who suggested doing a video on my top 10 favorite Charmed villains, and I absolutely love the idea, so here we are. This week, we will be taking a look at my personal top 10 favorite Charmed villains. Note, Zanku, the Source, and Cole are not on this list. As much as I liked Zanku, his lack of a backstory and or real character motivation or any sort of depth made it hard to appreciate him as a villain, if that makes sense. And Cole was kind of a decent villain in season 3, but then they just kept rinsing and repeating that in seasons 4 and 5 and it got real old real fast. And then the Source was just... Season 3 Source looked like he was going to be a super cool and very formidable foe, and then Season 4 Source was just a whiner. Literally, he spends more time whining because he doesn't get what he wants than he actually does attacking the Charmed ones, but yeah, those three definitely did not make the list. And someone else who didn't make the list, but definitely deserves an honorable mention, is Nomad. I didn't include Nomad on the top 10, given that he was never actually a villain in the sense that he fought the Charmed ones or even tried to hurt them. He actually allied with them as they had a common enemy, you know, that whole the enemy of my enemy is my friend thing and all. But Nomad was way too cool not to mention at all. He's like this charming combination of Jack Sparrow from Pirates and Jon Snow from Game of Thrones. And just, did I mention he was cool?
Mostly here for personal reasons.
May I ask what it's regarding?
Well, like I said, it's personal.
Why would a demon want our help killing another demon?
Personal reasons.
You do realize, of course, that taking out Billy and Christie will only eliminate today's problems. What about tomorrow?
What are you talking about?
What am I talking about? I'm talking about the Triad. You're gonna have to go after them too if you really want this nightmare to be over. Otherwise, they're going to keep finding new ways to attack you for another 8 years.
He is just so unbothered by everything and so smooth. I swoon. It's really too bad he was only ever in the one episode because I could easily see him having become a recurring role and a beloved one at that. But yeah, Nomad, you're awesome. Loved your character. With that being said, though, let's dive right on into the actual list. Starting with number 10, the Sorcerer. At the bottom of the list, we have the one villain I included solely because of his actor, Sebastian Roche. Sebastian is a much more well-established actor these days, having had roles like Michael on The Vampire Diaries and its spin-off The Originals.
Whatever you may think of me, I am a man of my word.
Actually, he's a liar. A beast and a degenerate. But in this exceptional instance, he may be of some use.
Oh, good. You're back.
Use this.
You just wouldn't be you if you didn't have a knife.
But back in 2007, he was still relatively unknown, which is when I first saw him on the soap opera General Hospital. Oh man, I was obsessed with GH back in the day. You have no idea. I was hooked. And then when the 2007 Metro Court hostage crisis happened, I swear I was glued to the screen every day at 3 o'clock, and that entire hour of my day, like, just pencil it out, I was busy. And my investment in this particular plotline was largely due to my fascination with the actor who played the main bad guy, who was, drumroll please, Sebastian Roche. He played the charming and playful, yet ruthless and somewhat sadistic, James Craig, who decided to take an entire room full of people hostage to keep the cops outside while he waited 12 hours for the vault inside the hotel to open and he could take the briefcase he wanted and GTFO.
I want the code in its entirety, or Six shoots Carly right here, right now.
Fun fact, I still remember the code to open that briefcase. 16 years later, it's 767-443. Anyway, James Craig being James Craig, and therefore a slightly sadistic a-hole with a lot of time to kill, decides to spend his time tormenting his hostages, either physically or emotionally, such as when he offered to let one hostage go, but forced Emily to choose which one, and she had to choose between her dying father and her best friend who had gone into premature labor. What a nice guy. But throughout all this, I was just taken aback by how good the actor playing him was. I mean, a lot of guest stars you see on shows are good, don't get me wrong, but when you find that special one that really just brings it and gives it his all, who isn't afraid to, like, go there, it's amazing to watch. And that is what Sebastian Roche did on General Hospital.
Bloody hell! Just made a fatal error!
Will you take a lot's guts?
You are such a bad example to your fellow hostages!
One.
No, D.A. Lansing, I'm not interested in anything you have to say!
So much so that once the crisis was over, I was a little sad that it meant that I wouldn't be able to see him on screen anymore because he really was that good. So I decided I would just start watching season 7 of Charmed to try and focus on something else because I didn't have the chance to watch season 7 while it aired. So when the DVD box set released in 2007, it was my first time watching any of the episodes. And to be honest, I wasn't overly impressed with season 7 of Charmed, so I'd gotten kind of bored by the time I hit the episode Carpe Demon, and so I was just kind of reclined and my mind was wandering, and I kid you not, the credits had just finished and I had literally just thought to myself, man, I wish Sebastian Roche had been on Charmed, when the guest credits started rolling, and would you guess who's one of the first ones listed? Sebastian freaking Roche! Like, what are the odds of that happening at that exact moment? I immediately sat up straight and could not believe it. I thought it must have been a trick of the light or something, so I rewound it a little bit, but yep, there he was. I can't believe it. The guy I had just got done watching on a show I really liked and thought he was a really good actor popped up in an episode of one of my favorite shows that I had started to watch for the first time, and I should have bought a lottery ticket that day or something, but I cannot tell you how excited my 13-year-old self was to see him on there. He played the sorcerer, essentially the Ursula of the episode, who had helped Drake become human, but with a little itty-bitty catch that he had come to collect on. And sure enough, Sebastian did an amazing job with his character, despite it being kind of a small role, and you can definitely see elements of that playful, sadistic charm he had on GH in his performance here.
Well, what are you waiting for? Come and get me.
The way he takes any performance and gives the character life is a treat, but getting to watch that on one of my favorite shows ever just made it all that more special.
Zaku is moving in to take over the underworld. If I expect to stop him and to seize the throne for myself, I must have Drake's powers!
And that is why he will forever hold a special place in my heart, and why he made it on the list. Thank you so much for coming on Charmed, Sebastian. And Vampire Diaries, you were awesome there too. Okay, moving on to number 9. Number 9, Matthew Tate. Matthew has always reminded me of something Dahofrin said in Buffy.
Haven't I taught you anything, Anya? Never go for the kill when you can go for the pain.
Because boy, oh boy, did Matthew live by a similar code. In his very first scene, we learn that he pretended to love Melinda Warren in order to be able to steal her powers, and once he had them, they couldn't be used against him, so she was essentially powerless to stop him. He could have just killed her and moved on to the next video, and no one would have been any the wiser. I mean, it was the 1600s. What were they gonna do? Track his cell phone data? But no, not Matthew. Using her, stealing her powers, that's not enough. No, he made sure to turn her in to the town council so that she would be burned as a witch. If Melinda hadn't cleverly stolen her powers back from him at the last moment and trapped him in a locket, I bet he would have been front and center in the crowd enjoying the spectacle he created. Again, I say, what a nice guy. And then a couple hundred years later, Rex and Hannah decide to trick Prue into releasing... Tricked her into releasing Matthew in the hopes that he would take out the charmed ones for them, and right away, we see just how clever Matthew is. Keep in mind, he has been stuck in this locket for 300 years. I feel like most of us would need a day or two just to get over the shock of that information, let alone getting any sort of game plan rolling. But right away, Matthew discerns that Prue must be related to Melinda, since she released him from the locket, tricks her into using her power against him so he can copy it, figures out that she's not alone, and that her relatives must have the other powers he wants, learns the family name is Hallowell simply by looking at the plaque on her desk, and begins systematically hunting down everyone named Hallowell in order to find the witches he's looking for. Seriously, I may not like Matthew and think he's a straight-up cad in addition to being evil, but there is no denying that he is also very cunning, highly adaptable in a new environment, can think on his feet, pun intended, and he knows how to use his surroundings to his advantage. Like, he knows his strengths and he knows how to use them. That is invaluable when it comes to being a villain. I mean, it's invaluable anyway, but you know what I mean. And he even manages to cause friction in Hannah and Rex's relationship by trying to charm Hannah, which I thought was hilarious.
What a strange time this is. So open, yet so closed. Where even a warlock feels shame.
Hannah, what the devil?
Oh, Rex, I told you I'd get him dressed.
10 minutes ago.
Oh, we've tried on many things. She says it is difficult to choose.
Playtime's over, big boy. You have a job to do.
Remember, he goes back from whence he came once his task is completed.
It's one of the few times you see Rex actually get mad. But anyway, the Charmed Ones realize they're no match for Matthew, so they summon none other than Melinda Warren herself to help stop him. And here's where you get to see just how twisted he really is. And he will kill you, but he wants you to suffer first.
You think I won't stop you?
How? You made your curse before, and you still burned.
And yet I'm here now, aren't I?
You're nothing more than a dead witch watching over stupid girls who are about to die themselves.
You won't touch them.
And that's where I'll kill her. And then I'll come back for the other two. That way, you can watch them die. And I can watch you suffer.
But of course, he gets his in the end and takes a one-way trip to Locketland.
Outside of gain, no only sorrow, no only pain.
Oh, no!
It's what you deserve.
This is not the end.
Ah! Yes, it is. This is for eternity.
All in all, a pretty cool villain. He was clever, charming, had a personality and something of a backstory, and was one of the few villains that actually had a tie to the Hallowell line, so that was definitely interesting to see. And you know, I miss these sorts of villains. This was one of the things that made Charmed so great. Number 8, The Soul Collector. In the episode The Power of Two, there's an evil ghost, Jackson Ward, that escapes Alcatraz, aided by a mysterious woman with an affinity for fire. She helps him in the hopes of collecting a witch's soul, but when Jackson fails, she takes his soul instead. The focus of this episode is technically on Jackson and stopping his vendetta, but to me, the woman helping him was always so much more sinister and creepy. You know how sometimes you just look at someone and you're like, that is not someone to mess with? That is a vibe I always got from her, and I always found her so weirdly fascinating, and I can't believe she was only ever in the one episode. With the way they were establishing her powers and abilities, it really felt like they were setting her up to be a much bigger threat later on.
Revenge, hell, mortal.
Go to hell.
That's what I do, only never alone. I ferry souls there. Everyone I can get my little hands on, so to speak.
Yeah, well, you're not gonna get your little hands on this one, lady, so just forget it.
Don't worry, Jackson. I don't want your soul. I want a witch's. They're prize catchers.
Especially with what she says after Jackson is vanquished.
Who are you?
I was hoping to take you or your sister. But it looks like your soul is safe. For now.
So, yeah, I mean, she was only in a few scenes and only had a few lines, but to me, I think she's a great villain, and it would have been awesome if she'd come back in a larger role later on, but regardless, she always has been, and always will be, one of my favorite villains to appear on Charmed. Number 7. Ames. Ames was not only one of my favorite villains, thanks to his sneaky, mocking demeanor, but I love me a smart villain, and he definitely checked that box. He not only has a master plan, but he knows exactly what he needs in order to do it, and has spent years and years patiently working towards it, one witch at a time. His plan was to hunt witches to obtain very particular powers, namely deflection, cloning, and transmogrification.
Trans what?
Before summoning a dark lighter and taking his crossbow, which just so happens to be the only thing that can kill a white lighter. He then attacks a witch in hopes that her white lighter will show up to heal her and he can kill them and take their orbing power, but unfortunately for him and his poor victim, they figure out his master plan and no one comes to help. After training and coming up with what they feel is a solid plan, they go to the witch whom Ames has now killed and easily defeat him and take the crossbow. A little too easily, they feel, and they're right. Ames didn't get as far as he did without being incredibly smart, and they realize too late that he obtained transmogrification, the ability to transform yourself, for a reason.
So, Ames didn't fight at all?
Not at all. I flung, he fled.
Did you wait for him, look for him?
No, we were playing by the rules. And we grabbed the crossbow, just like he said.
The crossbow.
She was right. Way too easy.
He kidnaps and kills the white lighter Natalie and uses her orbing power to ascend on high, but unfortunately for him, the charmed ones didn't get as far as they have without being quite smart themselves, and the minute Ames shows up, he instantly regrets it, and they vanquish him in epic fashion.
Kind of poetic.
I'm kind of in a rhyming mood. How about you girls?
Sure, this poison isn't working fast enough for me. Time for amends and victim's revenge. Cloning power turned sour.
No. Power to change turned too strange.
No. I'm rejecting your deflection.
So yeah, this episode was a bit of a roller coaster and I loved it. I think Ames was so sneaky and smart, and even though he didn't really have like a backstory or anything, I feel like he was still a pretty decent villain, especially in a season where it was kind of starting to feel like you were just watching the same thing over and over again. Definitely different, definitely cool. Number 6. Gideon. I wasn't sure whether to put Gideon on this list or not, since I know a lot of people can't stand him, but I really do feel like he was one of the better villains towards the later seasons, because to me, Gideon's character was a great example of the dangers of having an overly self-righteous mindset. And also, I feel like he was the embodiment of something Phoebe came to realize about misusing magic in season 2.
He was evil. He deserved what
wrong thing then for the right reason, still the wrong thing. Our job is to protect the innocent, not punish the guilty. And I crossed that line, and I know that.
And I always found that very intriguing. I mean, here you have this elder, a good guy by nature, who despite being a bit overdramatic and maybe just a little bit creepy, seems to have his heart in the right place and does what he can to help. But when he learns that Wyatt, a child he already feels is way too powerful, grows up to be evil in the future, he resolves to do a wicked deed, killing that 1-year-old child. Quote, for the greater good.
Wasn't he your friend too?
Yes, he was. We all have to make sacrifices for the greater good.
I'm evil. What do I care about the greater good?
Leo's son is just as much a threat to your kind as he is to mine. We made a mistake in allowing Wyatt to be born. In allowing such a concentration of power to be brought into this world in one being. But now that Leo is gone and the Charmed Ones are unaware, I'm one step closer to being able to correct that mistake. For good.
This pretty much becomes his mantra. No matter what he does or how evil that act is, like literally murder, he justifies it all, putting it all underneath the umbrella of the greater good.
But this too is for the greater good.
And as a side, I almost thought between the introduction of magic school and this greater good stuff that maybe they took inspiration for Gideon from Grindelwald's character in Harry Potter, but season 6 actually aired between 2003 and 2004, whereas Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows with the whole Grindelwald for the greater good stuff didn't release until 2007, so maybe it was the other way around and Grindelwald was inspired maybe just a little bit by Gideon? Who knows, but either way, I think Gideon is a great villain in the way that in Charmed, you see a lot of bad guy does bad things, but here we explore what happens when a good guy does bad things. And Gideon's character is full of things you see in real life. Lying, manipulation, moving people around like chess pieces to get them right where he wants them, all while telling himself he's right.
At least we're still alive.
Only because we barely made it back here in time.
Still, we healed each other and we can try again. Especially now that we can breach Wyatt's shield.
But the sisters know about us now. Worse, the imbalance has caused a shift in both worlds.
Which we should be able to use to our advantage to distract them whilst we complete our task. We created the imbalance. We should be able to repair the shift. And when we do, we'll make sure that the sisters forget everything.
And that's the biggest problem with this type of self-righteousness. If you refuse to see past your own nose long enough to even consider the possibility that you might be wrong, eventually you will find that you can't see if you're the problem until it's too late. And that's exactly what happens here. They eventually figure out that it's not a demon or a warlock that turned Wyatt evil in the future, it was Gideon himself. The trauma of having a trusted authority figure trying to kill you over and over to the point where you never feel safe poisons Wyatt's impressionable mind until it causes him to turn evil. In his campaign of trying to stop a threat, Gideon actually creates it and to his dying breath refuses to see it or acknowledge it.
Please, you have to understand. I am only doing this for the greater good, I swear.
How is killing a child ever for the greater good, huh?
Who the hell are you to decide that?
I'm an elder. So are you. It's what we do.
I'm not one of you anymore.
Leo, listen to me. You know what happens. You know what Chris came here to stop. Let me finish what I started.
Let me save the future. The only way it could be saved.
You're the reason the future's threatened, Gideon. Not Wyatt.
No.
But because of what you do to him. I'm about to make sure neither one of you get the chance again. Mirror! You can't do anything. I have to do this alone.
I know. Do what?
A great evil.
You have no idea what you've done.
And it's almost scary when you start to think about how many people in real life are just like Gideon. We see them all the time, especially in crime stories, so that's why I thought it was especially interesting when they actually touch on that in the season while trying to figure out who the biggest threat to Wyatt is.
Like trying to figure out who's after Wyatt. And I think I might have an angle on that.
You found the demon?
It may not be a demon. Look, we've relied on magic all this time and it's gotten us nowhere. And since I can't rely on my premonitions to help, I've had to resort to statistics.
Statistics?
Yes. Did you know that 50% of violent crimes are perpetrated by someone the victim knew? So don't you see? Whoever turns Wyatt evil might actually be someone we know or even care about.
A mortal? Impossible.
Really? Because the crime reporter at the newspaper said that it's usually someone you least expect.
So yeah, to watch this authority figure use his power and influence to get his own way was definitely a fascinating direction to take the show, and honestly, I wish they'd gone further with it. Not with Gideon per se, I feel like he died when he was supposed to, but imagine if Phoebe had taken her powers of premonition and empathy and gone into the world of fighting crime. The idea has actually been around for a long time, such as how she put two and two together on what the evidence meant in Which Proves It Anyway.
What about the evidence that Andy talked about? The trail of blood leaving the ravine where they found the first Prue?
We can't assume it's Gabriel's. The book says he's invulnerable.
To the weapons of man that wouldn't include a crystal sword that sucks away your soul.
Or how she figured out what Jackson Ward was up to in The Power of Two.
The son of a former DA was brutally murdered. The only quote-unquote evidence points to the last man executed on Alcatraz before it was closed down.
Jackson Ward.
How'd you know that?
Yeah, how did you know that?
I told you I was trying to figure out who the ghost of Alcatraz was, remember? Jackson Ward's name was at the top of the list.
Ghost?
Yeah. Hey, what's that?
Ultraviolet fingerprint. Although, technically, there's no such thing.
Could be the ghost's ectoplasm. It's outside the visual spectrum. Book of Shadows.
Ectoplasm?
Yeah. It's the ghost's skin. Hey, do you have a picture of this Ward guy? Yep. That's him.
Or when she actually used her powers to help keep a jury from convicting an innocent man.
Just because you don't understand magic doesn't mean that you have to be afraid of it.
Dear God.
What happened? Where am I? We summoned you, Angela. We need your help. Actually, your ex-husband needs your help.
Stan? Why?
He's on trial for your murder.
Stan? Are you kidding? He couldn't hurt a fly. He's an innocent man.
Shall we vote?
Yeah, I feel like this was always the path Phoebe was headed towards, and it's a shame the show never quite made it there. But yes, that's why, as much as some people can't stand Gideon, you can really learn a lot from his character, and that's why I think he's also a pretty good villain for the show.
Welcome to a fireside reading.
You are ruin, made flesh, made beautiful. You are loved, and so I despise you. That is why you are my foe, my dazzling count. You are that most precious thing, a worthy opponent.
Number 5, Billy and Christy, but mostly Christy. I know a lot of people can't stand Billy and Christy, but please just hear me out. I know that season 8 was a train wreck, but I actually feel like if it had been done right, having the final boss of Charmed end up being a second set of very powerful sisters would have been awesome. As it was, even though it was like really heavy-handed and the whole thing got very old very quickly and kind of even felt like it was being made up as it went along sometimes, there still managed to be some very interesting and even enjoyable parts of their story. And it's also kind of a neat introspection in what could have happened if, you know, one of the Charmed Ones had been more like Christie. Would the Charmed Ones have been the most powerful good witches of all time? Or would they have ended up doing what Billy and Christie did, which is sort of warping and twisting the idea of good to fit their own narrative? And, you know, just kind of like with Gideon, it raises some questions, a lot of what ifs, and, you know, kind of makes you think. Because, you know, if we look back at their story, you know, Billy is first introduced in the beginning of season 8 who, as a witch new to her powers that befriends the Charmed Ones and becomes something of a protege to them. To be completely honest, I didn't really like her at first. I thought she was bratty and annoying.
Look what you did! I had her!
Then why did you call for me? Again?
I didn't call you. I don't even know you.
Then maybe your inner witch does. Because sadly, I'm your white lighter.
Whatever that means.
You need my help whether you like it or not.
Are you a cop?
No.
Good.
And it kind of just felt like she was there to cause chaos, and it's like, haven't we been there, done that already? Why are we still doing this in season 8? But once they introduced the idea of Christie, her long-lost sister that was kidnapped by demons as a child, it gave her character a focus and an emotional arc, and she became much more easy to tolerate and, in my case, even like.
Thought you could use a little backup.
Oh, thanks. What about Leo?
Piper will call if she needs me. What's this guy's deal?
Well, someone hired him to take out Reinhardt. Same someone who knows about my sister.
What do you say we get some answers?
Whereas Christie, her sister, I never liked. Ever. She was first seen in the episode The Last Temptation of Christie after Billy, quote, rescues her from her long years in captivity. However, it soon becomes apparent that Christie is no longer an innocent victim and instead has become part of the problem, actively working with her demonic captors to undermine the Charmed Ones and manipulate her sister Billy into coming over to the dark side. All she really had to say is they had cookies and she would have got her, but she decided to go this route. Don't get me wrong, Chrissy's character is tragic in a lot of ways, and it's hard not to feel sorry for her. Kidnapped as a child, raised by evil that brainwashes you into believing that they're the good ones, and if she wants to save her sister, she needs to get Billy to see the way. But once she's around Billy and is in a positive and loving environment, Christie wavers, causing the triad to have their parents brutally murdered, which enrages Christie and fully converts her to the evil side.
They were my parents!
They were distracting you from taking the final step. Now, thanks to me, they no longer are.
Bastard!
Really, Christie never had a chance. Every time she tried to get back up, something or someone was waiting there to shove her back down. It is no wonder that she ended up the way she did, but that doesn't mean that Christie didn't become a villain herself. And after her parents are murdered, that's when Christie takes a much more active role as a villain, as she begins laying it on really thick, doing everything she can to try and manipulate Billy into believing that Phoebe, Piper, and Paige are the corrupted ones and they need to be stopped.
I can show you. The same way the triad showed me. I was meant to be taken, Billy, to be shown the way, just like you were meant to find me so I could show you.
The way?
Our path. It's the one we're meant to share together for the greater good. But before you can do what you have to do, first, you have to see that their core, their inner truths, are not for the greater good. That they don't deserve to keep their powers. They lost the way. Are you ready to see that?
Because you see Billy hesitate at every turn. These witches took her in, taught her their craft, let her move into their house. You know, they been there for her. They've done everything for her. She doesn't want to kill them. She doesn't even want to believe they're bad. So being a genuinely good and sensible person, she's constantly like, wait, let's just think about this. But Christy just isn't having it. She tries her best to get Billy to see her bloodthirsty, warped way of thinking. And it isn't enough to just disempower the Charmed Ones. They need to die.
I'm hoping we can disempower them so we don't have to hurt them.
Who are you kidding, Billy? It's going to take a hell of a lot more than that to stop them, and you know it.
No, I don't know it. I mean, besides, Piper has kids. She has a baby, for God's sakes. How can you even think of wanting to hurt a mom?
What about our mom? She didn't have any concern about her. So now I'm a nightmare.
No, going against good people is.
They're not good people, Billy. If they were, we wouldn't be in this position. They've lost their way. And the longer it takes for you to figure that out, the more time they have to attack us. Like they tried to do today.
What are you talking about?
They were here. I saw them.
Are you sure they were looking for us?
Billy. Stop. I mean it.
So what, are these hall monitors working for you now?
Does Billy know about this? Billy's not your concern anymore. And neither is this place. So just go now.
Sorry, that's a no can do.
What are you gonna do, Paige? Are you gonna vanquish me? Oh, wait. I'm human, and that's murder. That's illegal, isn't it?
That is, unless it's self-defense.
Okay, look, if they come after us, fine. I was wrong, we don't have a choice, but until they do...
If we give them enough time to attack us, we'll die!
And the thing is, this is one of the main reasons I think Billy and Christy make such good villains. They both have a point. They seem to represent two sides of the same argument. And, you know, Christy isn't wrong that the Charmed Ones have become extremely selfish and use their powers to their own ends. But Billy is also right that they do not deserve to die for it. And Piper, Phoebe, and Paige echo this sentiment on their own.
Admit they've become a little selfish, but they haven't done anything bad enough to deserve to die for it. But Billy, they will, and then it'll be too late.
Maybe Billy's right. Maybe we are selfish.
No, wanting a life doesn't make us selfish. It makes us normal.
Yeah, well, we're not normal. We're the Charmed Ones.
Nobody said we had to be that for the rest of our lives. It's not written in stone.
Yeah, and if wanting children and enlightenment and Leo back makes us selfish, then I'm guilty.
I'd say we've done enough. And that doesn't make us evil.
Well, I think it does from Billy and Christy's warped point of view.
So it's very interesting to me that they represent two halves of the same argument and something the audience might have even been debating. How selfish is too selfish? Where is the line and who decides what is too much? And how do you enforce that? You know, Billy seems to come from a place of there's enough for everyone. And Christy seems to come from a place of power, as in, the one with the most power should be the one who decides. The tension comes to a point where Christy and Dumaine even get Wyatt, who is, what, three? 3 years old? To help them obtain the hollow.
We didn't create this problem, Billy. They did. They're the ones who turn their backs on everything good. It's not our fault this is happening. Okay, listen to me, Billy. We've come this far. We can't go back now. If we don't do what we have to do, they're gonna kill us.
Unfortunately for them, the Charmed Ones also get help from the evil side, hi Nomad, and get the hollow at the same time. So it splits into both sets of sisters, giving them all massive power that leads to an epic showdown in the manner that I have always thought was awesome. I cannot tell you how many times I've repeated this scene. But this ultimately leads to the destruction of the manor and the deaths of everyone but Piper and Billy, who both use their respective powers to find a way to travel back in time and prevent the deaths of their sisters. But where Piper skips through time, meeting her various loved ones who volunteer to help her stop this terrible thing from happening, Billy goes to the one person she has, the one person she loves, just to realize what Christy has become and that she's the one who really needs to be stopped.
Triad. could have helped us figure out how to kill the sisters if they were still around. Okay, look at me. Listen to me very carefully. They don't care about us. They have twisted everything. They're using us, Christy. They're using us for our powers, our sisterhood, and our lives. So all we can do is kill.
And that's exactly what we're going to do, Billy. We're going to kill.
Well, I can't do it. I won't.
Then I'll do it on my own.
Christy!
Billy comes to the girls and apologizes for everything and helps them get rid of the triad once and for all, which absolutely infuriates Christy, who cannot accept that it's over, leading her to try to kill her own sister, who deflects the fireball back at her, ending Christy once and for all and breaking Billy's heart.
Christy, please. It's over. Just come home.
So, yeah, while this storyline definitely could have been written better, I personally think they shouldn't have made it so obvious right away that Christy was working with the bad guys, or at least not make it quite so heavy-handed and or forced, but I still think it was a very interesting idea for not only a villain, but the final battle of the show, to be two sisters with a lot of power against another set of sisters with a lot of power. Number 4. Barbis. Let's get the obvious one out of the way. So, Barbis is introduced in season 1 as the Demon of Fear, a demon who not only kills witches by reading their worst fears and bringing those fears to life, but actually relishes in it. He seems to really enjoy it as they suffer. Definitely an all-around bad dude, but his actor did such a good job bringing him to life that they just kept bringing Barbis back, and every time they did, we got to see more and more of his personality, and we learned that not only is he a demon of fear, but he's kind of funny.
What do you have to say for yourself, Barbis?
I'm a demon. What do you expect?
A total petty Betty.
Because those witches banished me to a fate worse than death, and the only thing that kept me going was the sweet thought of repaying the favor with interest.
And has a bit of a soft spot for theatrics.
Give me a break. Well, the new peeping elder, how the mighty have fallen.
I feel like I'm writing his dating profile. Oh, he's kind of funny, bit of a petty buddy, and has a soft spot for theatrics. Oh my goodness, I could totally see that. That shouldn't be as funny as it is to me. Anyway, my personal favorite appearance from him was in Sympathy for the Demon, not only because he had an amazing haircut, he looked so good, sorry, but it's true, but in that episode he manipulates Cole and Paige into allowing him to steal Cole's immense powers, and what do you think our dear Barbie does when he obtains nigh indestructibility? Does he A. get out of town, B. go on a killing spree, because really, who could stop him? C. organize the underworld and take over. Or D. use his newfound powers to terrorize the Charmed Ones just because he can. Yep, right in one. Little Barbs comes out swinging, turning the manor into a house of horrors, and even tricks Phoebe into nearly beating Paige to death. Yikes. Until, as it always seems to happen with ne'er-do-wells, his ego gets the better of him and the Charmed Ones take the powers back that he stole from Cole and vanquish him.
Looking for this?
Don't worry though, because we definitely see more of him, because as our dear Barbis says,
oh, you know, I'll be back. Fear always comes back.
Also, I forgot he said this in this episode.
Miss me, my babies.
I am so going to use this in a future intro if I'm ever away from YouTube for a time again, because it is just too funny. Miss me, my baby. I can't say it without laughing. But yeah, I think he is such an amusing character to watch. Even in the alternate reality where he was the demon of hope instead of fear.
You will be able to return to your time before it's too late, as you hope.
Well, don't touch me.
Oh, thank God.
Quickly, orb away. I will deal with him. I've done it before.
He even taunts Gideon, an elder, just because he can.
And your greatest fear is that somehow they're going to find out that you're the one that's after Piper's son. But don't be worried. I won't tell anyone, I promise. Nary a soul.
Do you see what I mean about petty and everything? You know, after a while, it's like Barbus doesn't even care about killing witches anymore. He just wants to screw with the Charmed Ones for fun. And the way he goes about it is so funny, and he keeps you entertained in a way that a lot of recurring characters don't. Because I feel like there's a fair few recurring characters I can think of where after a while it's like, okay, can you stop bringing them back, please? Like, it's over. The joke is done. It's dead. Barbus was never like that. Every time you saw him, you're like, oh, it's Barbus! Oh my God. I wish I could express to you how much I loved watching his character. Let's put it this way. I was in the hospital for 12 days last year, recovering from surgery. In that entire time span, I only turned on the TV once. And that was to see if Charmed was on. It was, but unfortunately it was season 6. But can you guess which episode was on? Crimes and Witch Demeanors. Yep, I love Barbara so much that he was responsible for the one time the TV in my room was turned on for almost 2 weeks. Love him!
Number 3. The Angel of Death.
Okay, so he's not technically a villain in the usual sense, but he's not exactly a good guy either, so I thought there was some wiggle room to be able to include him on the list, because I just loved his character so much, especially once I realized whose voice that was. I was watching him on Charmed as a kid, and I was like, I know that voice. Where have I heard that voice? And then in my head I heard,
I might be able to answer that question. Spell. You trapped a soul with a spell.
It wasn't intentional.
Reverse it now.
And immediately I was like, oh my God, that's Kane from Blood Omen. That's so cool.
Granted, we parted on poor terms.
You tried to murder me.
I seem to have failed.
Is that why you begged me to fight at your side when you wage war upon Nosgoth?
Begged? I never begged.
And yeah, getting to see slash hear someone from a video game you love on a show that you love was definitely pretty awesome. But also, the Angel of Death himself is awesome. You know, he just has this air of being so unbothered by anything. It's like, yeah, I'm the Angel of Death. Get over it. But at the same time, he seems to have this, not need, but determination to impress upon not only the Charmed Ones, but perhaps even the audience, the nature of death. And when he talks about it, you know, he is meant to be death personified, so you often find him slipping into a first person perspective, you know, like, you shouldn't be afraid of me, I'm inevitable, that sort of thing. But underneath that air of, you know, I'm too cool for school, he seems to really be not aggravated, but frustrated almost, that people fight it so much, people don't want to accept it and everything. It's like, you have to. Like, it sucks, it hurts, but you have to. Trying to fight it, trying to get around it will only make it worse. And he has some very wise words throughout his 3 appearances on the show, and you know, that's one of the things I love about his character. He's one of those people where when he's talking, he has your attention. You are listening.
You wanted me, now you've got me. You're wasting precious time.
I'm sorry, I didn't.
It's not my time you're wasting, it's yours.
You refuse to accept me for what I am, which keeps you from mourning me.
You don't know me. You don't know anything about me.
But I've seen it so many times before. The anger, the pain. You lock up your tears and angrily steel yourself against me as if I was the ultimate evil.
You are the ultimate evil.
No, I'm not good or evil, I just am. I'm inevitable.
So to save your sister, you would threaten to stop all death?
You got it.
That's rather selfish of you, don't you think? Unless, of course, you think that death is pointless.
Well, I...
It's not, you know. Far from it. Life only has meaning specifically because there is an end. Death is what forces people to live.
Yes, but...
Which means that ending death effectively ends life. Throws off the entire cosmic design. The whole point. And for what?
He has some very insightful dialogue and... You know, they couldn't have gotten a better actor for him. Simon Templeman is amazing. I wish he'd been on the show more. My favorite appearance of his on Charmed was in Sticks Feet Under. In this episode, there's a wannabe demon killing all of the human members of his family so he can fully convert to his demon side. But Cage? Oh my goodness. I've been at this too long. But Paige casts a spell to save one of them, and it doesn't really work as intended. So even though the man is technically dead, the Angel of Death can't collect his soul, and he's not very happy about that. Especially when he realizes that he also can't collect any other souls until he gets that one. And when the sisters... Piper refused to listen and even rubbed salt in the wound by mouthing off to him.
Undo the damage you've done to the grand design.
Damage? We've done more than almost anyone to protect your grand design.
Look, we should just leave it. We still have a demon to go after, okay?
You know, we've given up a lot to make sure you have less work. I have two kids and a business, and I still find time to fight demons, too. It's not our fault you can't keep up.
He's like, all right, think you can do better? There you go. And turns Piper into an angel of death to help him fix the mess.
I told you, I need your help.
Like, seriously, Paige is right. Don't yell at death. But actually, this ends up being beneficial to Piper, who by this point in the series has been through a lot, particularly in season 6 with that Gideon and Wyatt business. And Piper is just sick and tired of everything they go through day in and day out and is very jaded at this point in time about being a witch and everything that entails and being taken out of her own shoes for a while and having to experience some of what other people are going through seems to help her see past that in a way and give her a new appreciation and outlook on life. And it even seems to have an effect on Death himself, too, because he seems almost amused when the sisters ask to trade the demon who helped him earlier for Paige, and he actually agrees.
We changed the circumstances.
First, you want to stop a soul from moving on. Now, you want to add one.
Not add, trade.
His soul for Paige's.
This is unprecedented.
What? You can't do that.
Keeps your precious cosmic balance in order, doesn't it? What have you got to lose?
You can't be taking her seriously.
Dude, you're dead. Start acting the part.
This has been quite a remarkable day. Even for me. I wouldn't do that if I were you. Your sister made a trade.
Personally, I think he just liked them and wanted to help them, but I also think he didn't like that little demon. I mean, look at his face, like, don't touch me. And probably just wanted to get rid of him, and it's just like, sounds like a good trade to me. So yeah, he is awesome, and I love that he even develops something of a personal relationship with the sisters, enough to where he tries to give Piper a warning in season 8 that he's coming for Leo in order to give them time to say their goodbyes, which he did not have to do. I feel like Piper was a little bit ungrateful for that. It's not his fault. He's just doing his job, Piper. Leave him alone. But yeah, I feel like the Angel of Death is one of those characters that offers real world wisdom and advice and made such a lasting impression on me as a child. I don't know.
I guess he's just one of those characters that make you think. Number 2, Rodriguez. I swear, season 1 had some of the best villains, although I have to admit, Rodriguez was the first TV baddie ever to scare the absolute crap out of me. When he's first introduced in The Power of Two, I thought he was just your average inspector out to make life harder for Andy and our leading ladies, and well, I was right, but I also didn't see the fact that he's an effing demon coming until this scene.
Covering up for Prue Hollywood.
What? How the hell did you...
Oh my god, it still scares me even all these years later. I should not have watched this scene as a kid. But I have to admit, I do love his character and think he made a great villain. He had this weird charm and finesse, and what's more is that, unlike a lot of later villains, he had a pretty decent plan and was actually very smart in the way he went about it. Rather than go after Piper, Prue, and Phoebe directly, he chose to take a more indirect approach and worm his way into their lives via their cop friend Andy, posing as an FBI agent to use his power over Andy to put the Charmed Ones in a vulnerable position, which he actually accomplishes with the added bonus of assistance from Tempest, a demon who has the power to reverse time, and intends to do so each time Rodriguez fails so that he continues to learn from his mistakes and can ultimately take out all three sisters.
Right already.
Inspector Rodriguez, I'm here to see Prue Hollowell.
Yeah, no kidding. Prue, Piper, company!
Unfortunately, Rodriguez lets this failsafe make him overconfident.
No!
Andy!
Giving the girls a window that allows them to defeat Tempest by taking him out of his time loop, putting Rodriguez on his last chance. Rodriguez is even given the chance to walk away, but like every poor puffed up popinjay, Harry Potter reference, he just can't resist starting a fight. He is obviously going to lose, and he does. But while Rodriguez is long gone and forgotten by the Charmed Ones, I'll never forget how good a villain he was, or how much he scared me the first time I ever saw him kill his partner. And he also killed Andy, so like, definitely made an impression. Like, how could you do that? What'd Andy ever do to you? Why couldn't you have killed Daryl? Like, I'm sorry, but for real. If they had done more with Daryl's character, maybe I would feel bad. I would have personally loved to see Daryl's new partner be frickin' Cole. Could you imagine those two being a crime-fighting duo? Oh my god, I would watch that spinoff in a heartbeat. But as it was, they kind of made him too much of a background character who didn't have enough role in the show to justify his being there until they just got rid of him altogether. So, you know, that kind of sucks. Anyway, I'm just saying, I know Daryl got the short end of the stick, but that doesn't mean I wanted Andy to die either. And we have finally come to number 1, which is... Rex and Hannah. These two are my absolute favorite villains to ever appear on Charmed, hands down. Rex more so than Hannah, but they are a package deal, and I do love their rapport and the way they interact with not only each other and the Charmed Ones, but even other villains.
Who are you? How do you know me?
Well, the short answer is, we're the ones that gave the witch the locket that had you freed. I suppose you could say that we're, partners.
I work alone.
No, not in this century, you don't. You're new in town. You're in time. You need our help.
What do we do now?
I don't know. We're gonna have to think of something faster. He's gonna be none too pleased to learn that we have failed.
They're just so human, for lack of a better term. They had heart. They had character. The casting was fantastic, you know? They were careful. They were smart. They knew how to play their role of the nice, friendly boss and the somewhat snobby co-worker that you wouldn't turn your back on.
I believe that its mere presence would help a woman conceive.
Mm. You take it. My biological clock's not the one that's ticking.
Everything was done so perfectly, and I love them so much, even from their first episode, because, yeah, they're first introduced in the very second episode of Charmed ever, I've Got You Under My Skin, as the bosses in the auction house that Prue is interviewing in, having been invited to do so by Rex himself. You don't know this yet, though, so when you see Prue on the elevator headed towards the interview, pay close attention to Rex, who is the beautiful Brit in the blue shirt, by the way. And the way he reacts to Prue's phone conversation.
Hello?
Andy, how did you get this number?
I'm a detective, remember? Prue, I think we should talk.
Yeah, you know, it's just I'm really late for this interview.
I didn't mean for what happened last night to happen, Prue. You have to know that.
Of course, I'm, you know, totally wrong for it anyway. Stuffy old auction house, don't know why they even called.
Come on, Prue. Listen to me. We've known each other for a long time. We just couldn't help ourselves.
It's nothing to be ashamed of.
I know, Andy.
All we did was make love.
I know, Andy.
And talk to me. Help me out here, Prue. Why'd you sneak out like that?
I did not sneak out. Right? You were asleep. I didn't want to wake you. And I did write you a note. I just didn't leave it. Hello?
Rex Buckland, this is Prue Halliwell, interviewing for the new specialist.
Actually, we've already met. Welcome to my stuffy old auction house.
You see, this is one of the main reasons I love Rex so much. He's a bad guy, right? He's there to do bad things, take out our leading ladies. I do believe he and Hannah were bleeding the auction house dry. Just being a general ne'er-do-well, he shouldn't care about this sort of stuff, right? But he does. He loves drama. He eats it up. Eats it right out of the box. Like a crumble cookie. He will always take time out of his day for the amusement of watching other people squirm. And I love watching him do it. And it also doesn't hurt that I always thought Rex was super handsome and, in my opinion, could have even played an older version of Tom Riddle from Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets. I had a weird fascination with both of them as a child. So twisted, but so true.
I had to see for myself if the rumors were true.
We're gonna have to think of something faster. He's gonna be none too pleased to learn that we have failed.
Anyway, and then there's Hannah, Rex's lover and partner in crime. I have to admit, even with how much Hannah got on my nerves sometimes by being a little...
Personal call, Prue? Personal business, Hannah, and I swear that that's my name on the door. Ooh, look. Last turkey, no mayo. Ugh, my favorite.
Actually, I was saving that for Prue.
Yeah, you were. Don't you hate turkey?
Of course I do. I just don't want you to have it.
Is there any particular reason why you're such a bitch to me?
Yes, because it's my mission in life to destroy you.
Well, nothing like a bit of inter-office rivalry to get those competitive juices flowing. Hannah, a word. Hmm. What the bloody hell do you think you're doing?
I don't know. It came out.
You two know each other. Forgot.
No, you didn't.
I still thought she was absolutely gorgeous and that her actress did an amazing job of conveying just how complicated Hannah is. She's not just pure, unadulterated evil. She's
like I said earlier, very human in a way. She and Rex both are, and like I said earlier, they perfectly highlight what was so great about early Charmed. The way they give villains stories and personality. It wasn't just like, oh, we're evil because we're evil. It was always more complicated than that. And the writers would take the time to flesh these characters out and make sure the audience knew who they were, what their motivations were, and that at the end of the day, these villains weren't just villains, they were people. And by, I want to say, season 5, you really didn't see much of that at all anymore. And even though they did try to recapture that magic at times...
I'm here for the literature post.
And what do you know about literature?
Plenty. My resume.
It was just never the same. And as for Rex and Hannah, not only are they my favorite villains and easily my favorite duo, but you know what I love most about them? They actually won! Their plan worked! See, Rex and Hannah hired Prue at the auction house to watch her, figure out if she was actually charmed, and once that was confirmed, learn her weaknesses in hopes of defeating her and her sisters. They tried a couple things, such as unleashing Matthew, to which obviously the charmed ones summoned Melinda, which I always loved Hannah's reaction to.
They did what?
And once they had learned enough and felt ready to take on the charmed ones themselves, in the episode Wicked Envy, they put their ultimate plan into action. Rex would use his powers to project himself and psychologically suggest to Prue that she take her briefcase, which was actually a borderline priceless tiara, home with her.
It's your date book. Now put it in the desk, just like you always do. Excellent.
As the owner of the auction house, he would report the theft and use the same powers he used to manipulate Prue to help the police find the tiara in Prue's possession and get her arrested.
It doesn't matter. Just let them find it. I have nothing to hide. I'm innocent.
That doesn't look very innocent.
Piper, hide it.
You think you should check under the pillows?
Morris, check under the pillows.
He know to look there.
Put it in the dresser. He's already looked there.
You want to look in the dresser again? This is getting ridiculous.
This is getting ridiculous.
No, eerie is more like it. I will be right back.
You're a miserable witch.
What's the matter?
I don't know, I feel like calling a shrink for some reason.
While Hannah murdered the security guard and planted the tape showing the theft to secure her fate.
You're under arrest for suspicion of murder.
And when her sisters break her out, Rex catches them and offers them an ultimatum.
The drama, why didn't you just kill us and take our powers?
Don't give him any ideas.
No. I have seen exactly what you can do when you've been confronted directly. That is why I opted for blackmail. See, there is a special spell in the Book of Shadows that strips you of your powers forever. And this device will capture those powers. And you'll bring them to me.
Go to hell.
Yeah, I'd love to, darling. I miss it terribly. In return, I'll give you the photo. Tell the police I simply misplaced the tiara. No theft, no motive for murder, no prison. You really don't have much time. Just until the prison guards realize you've escaped.
Backed into a corner with really no other choice, they do just that and hand over their powers to Rex. And do you see what I mean? The plan worked. Hannah the Jaguar, Panther? Kitty Brat, that's my nickname for my sister's cat, by the way, was about to kill them in seconds. Like, they were seconds away from death. They lost. The only reason, and I mean the only reason, Piper, Prue, and Phoebe got out of this mess alive was because just at that moment, their plot armor kicked in, and Leo somehow healed the book and gave them their powers back, which is so bizarre and illogical. They never explain how he did this, and it never happens again, even though they lose their powers numerous times over the series. But whatever, my point is that
that Rex and Hannah won. They won the Game of Thrones. That should have been their chair. Like, come on. But, rant over. They lost. Charmed went on for 7 more seasons. Rex and Hannah died. Sucks. Oh my god, what am I saying? I'm rooting for the bad guy. The Charmed ones won. Yay! Good for them. I'm glad. Sorry, I love Rex and Hannah. But there you have it. Those were my personal top 10 favorite villains ever on Charmed. How about you? Who were your favorite villains? Anyone you ever wish would have made a comeback in later seasons that didn't? Any recurring characters that you enjoyed seeing? Let me know. And, oh, I don't know if you guys can hear that, but I should probably head off. I am currently cat-sitting my sister's little kitty cat, Kitty Brett, and he is already very mad that I shut him out of the closet so I could record in here. But the longer I'm in here, the more scratching I hear. I can hear him on the other door trying to get in. So I should go before he turns the bedroom door into a pile of wood shavings. Oh, and he will too. He is persistent. I love him so much. But I hope you liked the video, and please let me know if you have any suggestions for the future or anything you think would be cool to do for Halloween. This is Halloween. This is Halloween. Again, so excited. As always, I hope you have a wonderful day or night wherever you are. Bye. All right, love, you can quit shredding the door. I want to have one when this is all over.